hospitalized a couple times since I've been pregnant with hyperemesis, and the very first time was about a month ago, and I was throwing up for about 5 hours when I was taken to the hospital. The doctor came in and he explained to me and my sister and my husband, who were all in the room, he said, you're gonna have to be here for at least 5 hours getting liquids. And without skipping a beat, my husband said to my sister, okay, cool, because I saw a place where you can paint pottery nearby. You guys are like, is he gay? So my sister didn't even like, they didn't even like check in with me if it was cool that they left me. Like as soon as he said pottery, like they just left. And I was like, I'll be here. And about an hour and a half later, my sister rushed back in the room and she said, okay, listen, be nice to him about what he painted. I'm like, okay. She's like, I'm serious. He worked really hard on it. Okay. She goes, and it's not very flattering. I'm like, what? But my husband's brain is a little different. Because you go to these places, you usually paint like a teddy bear or a jewelry box, you know? But my husband decided to paint a plate, which he would use as a canvas to paint me. And I'm gonna show you the picture. I think it's important for you guys to see the picture. And I wanna show you this, and I want you to know that there were no qualifiers before he showed me this picture. He was sure it was pretty good. This is the picture that he painted. I was in the hospital, guys. I wanted to go, what's my chin on my neck? I look like Trump. I couldn't say any of this to him, okay? Yeah, here, get rid of it. People are leaving. This is upsetting. This is an upsetting image.
I got an American manager. Chad, the American manager. Never heard more crap come out of a man's mouth in my life. Kid, what do you gotta think about me, okay? Is that I'm not your manager. I'm your teammate, okay? And there is no I in team. No, but there is one in bullshit! Tricked me into signing with him, did Chad, as well. He was like, kid, you sign with me. There is a movie with a part in it. Oh my God, this part, it was written for you, kid. It was written for you. I represent the director. You sign with me, the part is yours. I was like, oh, great, thanks, Chad. Sign me up. Join the agency. Audition for the part that was written for me. Didn't get it. Went to see the film 6 months later. Do you know who was playing the part that was written for me? Idris Elba. Idris Elba. Now, I'm not having a pop. Obviously, Idris is a great actor, and, you know, in hindsight, he probably made a much better Nelson Mandela than I would have. It's fine. I have been on a long walk to freedom. No, it wasn't right. Don't do the voice. It's not even the worst audition Chad got me. The worst audition Chad got me came when I was in America last. Now, before I tell you what this audition was for, I need to give some of you a little bit of backstory about my acting career. When I was at school, I was a big fan of drama. I know, shock horror. Not the only fan of drama at my school, though. The other guy that was really into drama at my school was a chap called Robert Pattinson. There he is, young R. Pats, star of the Twilight films. And every time there was a school play at my school, Robert Pattinson would get cast in the lead role, and Villager 17 would go to this guy. Yeah, laugh it up! For some reason, my drama teacher wanted the star of his play to be the young James Dean and not the young K.D. Lang. And it's fair to say that over the years, I built up a little bit of resentment towards our Pats. He became my rival. Rival's a strong word. Nemesis. He is my nemesis. And I've made a lot of jokes about him before. I've called him a wooden actor. I've written an entire show about him. I have milked that titty dry for every droplet of its bitter, bitter milk. And eventually, I woke up one day and I was like, you need to put that anger away in a box. You need to hide it away and you need to get on with your life. And I vowed that I would never speak about Robert Pattinson on stage ever again. And it was going really well. Until Chad called me up out of the blue. He was like, kid, oh my God, I got you an audition for a movie. This part is amazing. And get this, in this movie, you would be starring opposite Robert Pattinson. OMG. FMLWTF. And you know what the word was that chimed? Opposite, right? Not below, not beneath, not behind Robert Pattinson, opposite Robert Pattinson. After all these years of feeling inadequate at his hands, finally me and my nemesis were on a level playing field and it felt amazing. I was like, well, Chad, tell me about the part. You know, what are we? A couple of swashbuckling heroes? You know, good cop, bad cop? Two dashing gents competing for the hand of a fair maiden?
He went, no, not quite. In this movie, you would be playing Matt. And Matt,
get ready for it, right?
Matt is Robert Pattinson's character's mentally handicapped brother.
Yes, I thought it was a tasteless joke as well. 10 minutes later, that dropped into my inbox. It was a genuine audition to play the younger brother of Robert Pattinson with, to use the politically correct term, Chad, learning difficulties. So I had to go away and have a little think about this offer, okay? I told my friends, they all thought it was hilarious. I told my father, slightly more pragmatic about the whole situation.
He went, well, you've got to go for it, son. Those kind of parts are Oscar bait. Look at history. What's eating Gilbert Grape, Rain Man, Forrest Gump? You know what they say, son? Play a mong, get a gong.
No, they do not say that. You have just said that. But here's where the ego of the actor kicks in. Within about 5 minutes, I'm thinking, well, he has got a point. This is my chance to prove to the world that I'm a serious actor. I'm taking the audition.
It was the weirdest audition I have ever done. The first thing that was unusual about this audition is that there was no script.
I was told that I would just have to walk into the room with the casting director and improvise in character.
Well, I had to ask some questions.
I went in, the casting director was sat there. I was like,
Hello, I just needed to know, how mentally, you know, do you want me to be?
He was like, what you're doing now is fantastic.
I haven't started! The note that came back was amazing. They referred me to the original email. They said, what we want from your character, everything about him should be dulled and emotionless. From facial expressions to the tone of his voice. I said, is it not going to look weird if I'm doing the exact same thing as Robert Pattinson?
Burn.
Yeah. Woo.
Yeah, I didn't get the part.
That leads me to my favorite type of communicating online, which is one-on-one. Does anyone text with their parents? Okay. Did anyone teach their parents how to text? All right, seems like it's going pretty good based on the two people who clapped. I taught my mom how to text. I feel like she made very quick progress, which I just wanted to detail. In brief, she started out writing texts like emails. My nickname, Ups, would be the subject in bold. Then she would start a message. Hope Nashville was fun when we got married. Dad would. And then she would just get tired and walk away from the phone. Because this is all we ever got of this one. When we got married, Dad would. I'm like, oh, it sounds like Dad. It's classic, classic Dad move. Then she started using it more practically. This is when we were in the museum together. She wrote, tell me before you go to next floor, I'm with Picasso. So I write, so we meet at the exit in 7 minutes. And then within seconds, she responds, already on ground floor and hungry, please. Apparently my mom moves through art museums at raptor-like speeds with an insatiable need to feed. But I think food just makes her very antsy. One time I got these back to back. Ups, I bought you a sandwich at Blossom. Did you get my message about sandwich? She needs to move the product. Then she got really advanced. One day, she just straight up sent a blurry photo of the moon with no context. Except an hour later, this came in. Bigger and brighter moon today, lovelies. Now, I don't know if this means my mom is now amateur weather reporting or this is the first sign she's becoming a witch, but either way, I'm here for it. She also was author of this. Remember I told you about the man with the funny first name? Please don't share with anyone. Like, that's not fair. You know what I do. Sabotage, the first degree. And then, I don't know how many people are familiar with the iPhone handwriting function. It definitely wasn't made with her in mind, but one day, this line just comes in to my sister and I, and my sister's not gonna let it go, so she just writes, what is that line for? Which is definitely a reasonable question. And I guess my mom took an improv class at some point, because she was ready for it. She just responded, that is life, however you want to interpret it. It keeps going. I was like, oh man, game, set, and match. You win that one. And you know, you're like, oh, your mom's pretty advanced. Where does your dad fall in all this? He's a little more limited. Started out writing texts like this. That was sort of a classic one from him. And you know, he's not a man of many words, so that was a lot for him. Then he sort of evolved into like a mild interrogation, like what? It was sort of phase two. And now he can write a full message. Hey Ups, what time can we expect to have the fun of your company? We'll help plan our day better. Unfortunately, the emojis don't always match the tone of the message. This is some kind of fear-love combination. I guess you could argue most love comes from fear, so really he's quite deep.